Yes, class, this we are doing in continuation, thermal properties of matter. In the previous class, we have discussed what is heat, that is a form of energy. And we have discussed about the specific heat, latent heat, all these terms we have discussed in the previous class. Today, in continuation, we are going to discuss what are the different modes of transfer of heat. It means how can I transfer heat from one person to another or one place to another place. So there are three methods with me for the transfer of heat. One is the conduction method. In conduction method, the energy from one particle is transferred to the another by like if I make you stand in a line and you just give one parcel from one person to another and then to next, it will reach to the last person. So by the actual contact, I can say in convection method, the particle itself goes. These are three methods. Like if I take that there are persons standing here and in the conduction method, if I want to transfer heat from A to D, then A will give heat to B, B will give to C, C will give to D, and then heat will reach to the D person. This is conduction method. Like one person is giving to the next and next to next and so on. But in convection method, the A himself will travel, or this particle will travel and take the position of the D particle. Here it will go by the convection method, by the actual movement of the particle. Here the particles were staying on their position in conduction method. In convection method, the particle moves and it gives heat to that particular position. In radiation method, the heat will go from A to D without affecting the intermediate medium. So these are three methods with me for the transfer of heat. One is conduction, another is convection, and the third is radiation. Of course, we have to go in detail of all these three methods. One by one we will be doing. So in the beginning, to start with, first method I have taken, that is thermal conduction, or simply conduction you can write here when I'm talking about the thermal properties of matter. So when I'm saying conduction means thermal conduction, because you have done conductivity in 10th class also when it is electric current is made to flow. Today we are talking about the heat conduction, it means thermal conduction I may say. So the process in which heat is transferred from one part of the body, which is another part, which is at lower temperature, without the actual flow of matter. So matter will not flow, but one particle will give the heat to the another particle and so on without moving, I can say that is the conduction. So if I take a thin rod, I'm putting the wax or particles over it, and if I heat from one end, this become hot end of the conductor. This is of course heat conductor we are talking about. So like I may take any metallic bar with me, then what will happen? You can observe these wax particles will start falling with time. So after some time, this thin rod, which is metallic rod, will attain the thermal equilibrium, same temperature I can say. So in this, actually what is happening, that molecules at the hot end, they vibrate with the greater amplitude and greater kinetic energy. And when they, during vibration, like in waves you have studied, during vibration, when they come in contact with the neighboring particles or the neighboring molecules, they transfer the energy. So this way energy, heat energy is getting transferred in the form of kinetic energy. And as a result, the second part end of the thin rod is also get heated till it is attaining the steady state. Steady state means same temperature of the thin rod is attained. So one term which you may come across, that is temperature gradient. Like we have done pressure gradient in fluids, change in pressure with distance. So if I'm taking change in temperature with distance, that is the temperature gradient. So if I'm taking this X length of thin rod, which is maintained at the temperature T1 and T2, then I can write temperature gradient as T2 minus T1 upon X. So this way you should be able to write the temperature gradient. Very important with you this derivation, when I ask you to find the this coefficient of thermal conductivity. So for that we are going in detail of thermal conductivity, and I will be introducing a term to you, that is coefficient of thermal conductivity. So we have taken a rectangular block, of course metallic block, which should be able to conduct the heat, and let this first phase is maintained at temperature T1, and that is of course the higher temperature, and the another phase T2 is at a temperature T2, second phase, which is cold phase I'm calling, that is at temperature T2, and of course I'm assuming T1 is greater than T2. If I take X as the thickness of this slab or block, I can say, and capital A as the area of cross section, then of course heat will travel by its property, like water always flows from higher level to the lower level by itself till it attains the equilibrium, or means the same level in two containers, like you have seen in the resonance tube also. Two parallel pipes are there, if they are connected then water by itself will flow. Similarly, heat also by itself it flows till it attains the thermal equilibrium. So this term thermal equilibrium is also should be clear in your mind. So it has been found that if I take the amount of the heat that is flowing from hot phase to the cold phase at steady temperature, if I call this quantity of heat or the amount of heat as capital Q, then this amount of heat is directly proportional to the area. Area A of the surface, and it is directly proportional to the temperature difference, it means T1 minus T2. And it depends that how much time it takes to attain the steady temperature. Small t, I'm writing for time. And further, it is found that it is inversely proportional to the thickness of the slab. So if slab is more thick, means block is of higher thickness or of small thickness, so the amount of heat will be inversely proportional to that thickness. So these all things you can even observe in your day-to-day life also. So if I combine all these equations, then I'm getting Q is directly proportional to A delta T, or you may write T1 minus T2 into small t divided by X. Capital T we are using for temperature, small t we are using for time. That is to be noted, and you must mention in the derivation whenever the derivation is being asked from you. So when I remove this sign of proportionality, I get a constant, and that constant I'm writing it as K, which you may design it in a different way, because K we are using number of times, K Kelvin we are using for the unit. So better you design it so that just to differentiate it. So K is the term which is termed as coefficient of thermal conductivity. So you can be asked with the definition of this K, coefficient of thermal conductivity. One capital K we are using for the unit of temperature, that is Kelvin, that we have discussed in the previous class. This K we are calling it as coefficient of thermal conductivity, which is the constant of proportionality. And if I take the rectangular slab of area unity, temperature difference also is unity, time is also one unit, and thickness if I take equals to unity, then this K, it becomes equals to Q. Q is the amount of heat which is being transferred. So I can define that the coefficient of thermal conductivity, it is equals to the amount of heat transferred through a unit area of the slab for a unit time when temperature difference is maintained by unit, means 1 Kelvin or 1 degree Celsius, and the thickness of the slab is also unity. So this way you can define the coefficient of thermal conductivity. Most of the times this definition is asked, so you should be able to write. Now if the area is not uniform, then I can say the heat is given by dq by dt. And dq by dt means I should be using the same expression from here. dq by dt, I will be getting ka dt by dx. dx can be taken as the thickness, or simply x you can write. Of course, you can write the units and dimensions of capital K, which is the year's coefficient of thermal conductivity. So as I've said, you can design it in a different way so as to differentiate it. So K, that is written as Qx divided by A T1 minus T2 into small t. So Q is heat. So that is equals to joule unit. For distance, it is meter. For area, it is meter square. For temperature, it is Kelvin. And for time, it is second. So I'm getting SI unit is joule per second per meter per Kelvin. While in CGS, if you write, you are getting calorie per second per centimeter per degree Celsius. And of course, you can find the dimensional formula by writing the dimensions of the heat energy, that is ML2T minus 2, that is the dimensional formula for the energy. For distance, you can write L. For area, you can write L square. For temperature, Kelvin. For time, it is capital T dimension. So this should be clear because we are using same symbols number of times. So you should be able to get the things from your previous knowledge as well. This I'm getting the dimensional formula for the coefficient of thermal conductivity is MLT minus 3 K minus 1. Here K is of course Kelvin, T is the time. So must note the units and dimensions for K, many times asked in your exam for 1 mark. Next with you is similar to the your electrical resistance you have done in the 10th class. You can talk about the thermal resistance. It means how much a particular material will allow the heat to pass. Like wood is an insulator, means it is not allowing the heat to travel. Similarly, different materials, they will allow in a different way. So heat, which is given by the quantity of amount of heat passing per unit time, that is the heat energy I'm writing. So the units will be of course joule per second, or you can say watt as the power and the current electricity you say. And electrical resistance R, as you write, R by Ohm's law, V equals to IR, I can write R equals to V upon I. Similarly, thermal resistance you can write by delta T upon H. It means temperature difference to the heat flow. How much you are able to get the temperature difference by allowing the heat to flow. So because H I can find, I know that is equals to delta Q by delta T, or simply Q upon T I can write. Whatever way you write, either you write delta Q by delta T, then also it is correct, but then you have to use the similar symbols always. So Q, I have taken the formula for the amount of heat which is flowing, that is your coefficient of thermal conductivity into A delta T by delta X into T. So I'm getting the value of H here by putting this value of Q, I'm getting KA delta T by delta X. So I'm getting this value here, delta X upon KA. This is the value of the heat resistance, or I may call it as a thermal resistance, which is units I may say is your Kelvin per watt. It means Kelvin divided by joule per second, which is joule per second is 1 watt. So I can write it as Kelvin per watt. So not to be confused with kilo term. So that also you must be writing K for Kelvin and W I'm writing for watt. And similarly, you can get the dimensional formula also, which is M minus 1, L minus 2, T3, K Kelvin K. So whatever quantities you are coming, bachche, because now you have to, earlier in the previous chapters we were writing in three basic terms, mass, length and time. Now Kelvin is also to be added because we are having seven basic quantities. So four quantities we will be writing here in this chapter of heat and thermodynamics. If I talk about the applications of thermal conductivity, which you have observed in your day-to-day life, on that also you may get the conceptual questions. Like you have seen the cooking utensils, they are provided with wooden handles. Because if you are holding from the wooden handle will not get heated up. So you can hold the cooking utensils, which are of course metallic, because they can good conduct, they are good conductors of heat. They allow the heat to flow. It means you can cook the things in those utensils, but handles are always made up of wood or some insulating material so that you are not getting harmed by it. Similarly, a new quilt is warmer than the old quilt, because in the new quilt you can see when air is there, that is of course providing the better insulation as compared to the old quilt, because that air must have lost, which is there in between the two layers. Similarly, ice is packed in sawdust so that it is not getting melted when transferring from one place to another. Eskimos, which are made up of double walled houses of the block of ice, though they are made up of block of ice, but they are able to get the air in between, which is heated up. So we are able to get its effect, means it is, they are not becoming that cold. Similarly, a refrigerator is also provided with the insulated wall, so that even if you touch, that wall is heated up, but that is simply protecting your food and that temperature is not getting lost. So we are able to maintain the temperature by the knowledge of conduction of heat. Another process or method for the transfer of heat, that is the convection. As I've said, in convection, the particle itself moves. Heat is flowing from the region of higher temperature to the region of lower temperature by the actual movement of the material particles. This can be seen when you heat the water. If I put some KMnO4 in it, so KMnO4, that is purple pink in color, so I can see the movement of those purple particles and I can see these designs will be formed, because the particle from the lower side, which is getting heated up, they travel up. They are traveling up and thus they are able to get the, means all the particles, they will get heated up after some time by the actual movement of the material particle. So this point is to be noted. In conduction, there is no actual movement, but in convection, it is the actual movement of the material particles is there. And on the basis of that, many applications you have seen, that is you have studied even in the lower classes, the formation of land and sea breezes, and regulating temperature of the human body. We are able to maintain the comfortable room temperature in the cold countries by this knowledge of convection, and similarly in the formation of trade winds. So more applications of this can be added. So this process, you are already aware of convection method. The third, which is important method for the transfer of heat, is radiation. Like we are getting the sun heat to our place without disturbing or without heating the intervening medium. So heat is transferred or transmitted from one place to another without heating the intervening medium. This is to be noted further. That is your radiation method. So when we are sitting near the fire, we are able to feel the warmth due to the radiation method. Similarly, heat from sun is reaching to us by the radiation method. So you should be able to distinguish the three methods, of course, for the transfer of heat, and further their application should be clear. Like on this radiation method, which we have to go in more detail with you. Prevost scientist gave the theory for the heat transfer, that is for the dynamic equilibrium, and he said that a body which is good absorber of heat is also good radiator. It means whatever heat it is absorbing at a certain time, it will be able to radiate at some other time. And if you have studied, of course, light waves in your lower classes, these are electromagnetic waves. Though in detail of electromagnetic waves, we will be going in 12th. But you should be knowing that light, it is not in need of any medium to travel. And similar to that, this method of transfer of heat, which is the radiation method, it is not in a need of any medium. While in conduction and convection, you have seen we are using the medium particles or the material particles. So these thermal radiations, you may say they are acting as electromagnetic waves. Of course, they can be reflected, they can be refracted, they can be transmitted, they can show the phenomenon of interference and diffraction, etc. And they don't need any material medium, or they do not affect the material medium. And they are actually the infrared radiations whose wavelength, you can see, is varying from 1 micrometer to 100 micrometer. So these are the electromagnetic waves. This is to be noted. And so all the properties of electromagnetic waves are followed by heat radiation. Give the law of cooling, as I was speaking to you in the previous class also, that if we go with the rate of loss of heat, that is directly proportional to the temperature difference. It means dq by dt is directly proportional to T minus T naught, where T naught, I'm taking the temperature of the surrounding, capital T, I'm taking the temperature of the hot body. So if I, because it is loss of heat, so that is why negative sign. Negative sign I have written because of the loss of heat is there. And it is directly proportional to the temperature difference. When I remove the sign of proportionality, I'm getting the constant K here. Again, small K I have written, that depends upon the nature of the surface. But we have studied that this amount of heat, that is equals to MC delta T, where C is the specific heat, dT is the temperature difference. Then I can write dq by dt with the time change if I want to write to find the rate of flow of heat. Then that is equals to mc dt by small dt. Small dt is the change in time. And this first and second equation, if I compare, then on comparing, you can see I can write that minus dq by dt means with this term I can write minus sign. Minus mc dt by small dt, it is equals to kt minus t naught. Or I can write dt by dt, that is equals to minus k upon mc t minus t naught. This k upon mc, I can take some another constant, again say k, but of different way I have written. So I'm getting this dt by t minus t naught, I can write it as minus k dt. And on integrating this, I'm able to get that log of E T minus T naught, it is equals to minus KT plus C. So temperature difference is changing with time. This is giving me the parabolic curve inverse. This relation is there, exponential relation is there, because T minus T naught, it is equals to E power minus KT plus C. So because of the exponential relation, I will be getting the curve like this. But yes, if I plot the graph for log of ET minus T naught with time, I'm getting it with a negative slope. And of course, we can verify it by simply taking a calorimeter. And here I may have the double walled container in which I can put a thermometer. I'm having the calorimeter container in which I put the thermometer. Here insulation is there. And here, of course, water, tap water can be taken. Here also water at higher temperature can be taken. Thermometers can be set where the, of course, wooden covering is there, and we can note the temperature T1 and T2, surrounding temperature and temperature of the hot water, and then we see the change in temperature after every 5 minutes or 1 minute I can see. And then if I do the graph plotting, I was able to get this graph. So this is, of course, experimentally verified also. Newton's law of cooling is experimentally verified. Now, when I talk about the heat is falling on a substance, Q amount of heat, then some amount of heat is getting reflected, some is getting absorbed, some is getting transmitted. And if I divide by the quantity of heat which I am making to flow, then I get small r, which is equals to capital R upon Q. Capital R is the amount of heat reflected, if capital Q is the total amount of heat falling on the substance. This is named as reflectance. This is another term with you, reflectance, small r, it is equals to capital R upon Q. Similarly, absorptance, that is small a, can be written as capital A plus divided by Q, that is total. Q is the total quantity of heat which is falling on a body. Like you say with the light, you say some light is reflected, some is transmitted, but here some is absorbed also. So similarly, transmittance, that is written as capital T upon Q. Monochromatic means single wavelength. So monochromatic reflectance, that can be written as R lambda. Similarly, monochromatic absorptance can be written as A lambda. Monochromatic transmittance can be written as T lambda. And it is found that sum of these three, R plus A plus T, that is equals to unity. It means 1. So if a body is neither reflecting nor transmitting, it means it is absorbing all the heat falling on it. And such a body with us is a black body. Black body, which is of course black in color, that is not totally black, but it should, because that is also even giving some heat out. So black body, perfectly black body, is that body which is neither reflecting nor transmitting, but it is absorbing all the heat falling on it. So absorptive power of the black body is unity. It means whatever heat you made to fall on it is getting absorbed. Even the lamp black is not perfectly black. So Faraday, the name of a scientist is there, who made a perfectly black body. So he took a double walled container in which you can see it is hollow from inside, and inside he polished with the lamp black, and outer coating was nickel coating, white color, so it is not allowing any heat to come out. So when, and of course a projection is made just opposite to the opening, this opening is very small opening is there, single ray I can say heat radiation can move in it. So when heat is going into it, it is getting reflected number of times, and as a result it is not allowing any heat to come out. So this body we are calling it as the perfectly black body. Perfectly black body, that is an ideal body. But though, even if this body also, we can see that 99.9% absorption is there. So 0.1 there is flow also. So that also should be kept in mind. And we are able to study the greenhouse effect, due to which we are able to keep the Earth's surface warm at night. Because once the radiation is coming out, it is getting reflected number of times and getting trapped inside the Earth atmosphere, and the Earth atmosphere is not allowing the infrared radiations to move out. That effect, we are calling it as the greenhouse effect. These terms you have done in the lower classes also. This is very important with you. Stefan Boltzmann law, according to it, whatever total heat energy is emitted by a perfectly black body per second, per unit area, so this E is the heat energy per unit area per second, that is to be noted. that is directly proportional to the fourth power of the absolute temperature of its surface. So E is directly to T4. But when you write the units and dimension, you should be knowing this energy is per unit area per second. And if I remove this sign of proportionality, I'm getting a constant sigma. This sigma is your Stefan-Boltzmann constant, which is given by the scientist itself. And its value you can write, and that can be used in the numericals. That is 5.67 into 10 to the power minus 8 joule per second per meter square per Kelvin 4. If I say that H is the rate of radiant energy emitted by a black body, then I can write H equals to E into A. That is because it is H of dH by dt, that is the heat of radiation which is emitted. So I can write it as sigma T4. And if I have like Ferris black body, my outer is maintained, means surrounding is maintained at T naught, then this Stefan-Boltzmann law, that can be written as E equals to sigma T4 minus T naught 4. So these two formulas you must keep in mind can be used in the numericals depending upon whether we are talking about the black body or under the normal conditions. But of course, these laws, they are applicable for the black body. Similarly, Wien, a scientist, has studied that if we maintain the black body at different temperatures, then total energy which is radiated by a black body, that is not uniformly distributed over all wavelengths. So when he studied the amount of energies for different wavelengths, he found that maximum value of the wavelength is shifting, see, towards the lower side. It means lambda m is increasing when, lambda m is decreasing when I'm increasing the temperature. So inverse relation is there. So he said that lambda m is inversely proportional to the temperature. Or I can say lambda m capital T, T is of course the temperature, that is equals to a constant B, proportionality constant, which is termed as Wien's constant. And its value is found to be 2.9 × 10⁻³ meter Kelvin. So this you have seen in your day-to-day life also, that when you heat an iron piece in the hot flame, its color is changing. Initially it is a dull red, then it becomes completely red, then yellow, and then it becomes finally, you can say, white in color. So it means what is happening on increasing the temperature, emission of the energy is maximum corresponding to the smaller wavelengths. So I can say lambda m is inversely to T. So this way you are supposed to keep things up to this for today. Of course, we will continue with the things, and of course you can try more numericals with you on the basis of this. Thank you, everyone.